Harshit, I am a software developer at Uber, and today I'm going to talk about UI testing, mostly about Espresso. Cool, so the things we are going to cover in this talk is basically Espresso basics, and then some of the recipes we use internally at Uber to write more reliable Espresso tests, and what are the things we can achieve with Espresso. Cool. So these are the things we are going to use. One is Espresso itself, the Gradle build variants, OKHTTP. We are going to use Dagger 2 just a little bit, then UI Automator, and screenshot test I'm not going to cover today. So basically, first I want to discuss what is UI test and why do you need it. This is a test funnel, it's proposed by Google. What it says is that you can break your test in three different test cases. One is end-to-end, the other is integration, and finally you have unit tests. And what they suggest is to write 70% unit tests, 20% integration, and 10% end-to-end test. So why do we need big tests? Like, why is unit tests not good enough? Cool. So these are the issues. First of all, unit test is fast. Same holds true for integration tests also. Like, they are fast. They are reliable. They isolate failures. So because you are just running a very small feature, the failure, you can pinpoint the point failure itself. But the only problem with unit tests is that they don't simulate a real user. Like, even if you are using unit tests on Android, you must be using RoboElectric, which is just a shadow of the actual framework. So yeah, I'm going to talk about Espresso mostly in the integration test. I'm not going to discuss about end-to-end tests because there are just way too many caveats here, just many points of failures, and yeah, you make actual network calls, so yeah, just too many points of failures. Cool, so Espresso is a very simple API, very simple fluent API. What it shows is on view, you provide the view matcher, and then you perform some view action, and then you check the view assertion. So yeah, here is a life-changing app. What it does is that when you click the Hello World button, the button gets disabled. So first what you do is that you find the Hello World button itself, and that's what with ID does. That's the view matcher. It locates the view within view hierarchy. So with, you can send the resource identifier r.id.helloworld, and it gives you the Hello World button. What you did next is, you can do next is that you can click the button itself, and then after click, once the button is clicked, it can be any other action also, like long click, scroll based on list view, and then finally you can verify that the button was disabled after the button is clicked, and that way you can make sure that nothing is broken in your production app. So view assertion basically asserts the current state of your screen, of your UI. So the next thing I'm going to talk about is rules. These are simple JUnit rules. How many of you have ever used rules like before, and when you are writing JUnit? Cool. So rules are really powerful way. One sample rule I want to show you is temporary folder. So once, and you can use multiple rules using chaining. So what this rule does is that when you write a test, inside this test, when you create different files, once your test ends, this rule, temporary folder, deletes those files. So you are clearing up resources and you don't have to write tear down. So rules are really great if you want to use an object in global scope, modify it, and then in tear down, you don't want to take care of clearing the state. An example is, like, let's say you have an A-B test manager, a mock A-B test manager that's in the global application scope, and what for a particular test you can write a rule, A-B test rule, and for a particular test, what it does is that it puts that A-B test in treatment, and once that test ends, it tears it down and you don't have to write it yourself. So yeah, it adds basically behavior on runtime. Cool, so I want to show you how to write a custom rules. Anyone here have written custom rules? No one? Okay. So yeah, you can write custom rules. It's very simple to write. First you define a custom annotation. We call it annotation X. And then you can write, so you can just extend test watcher. Test class have two simple methods, starting and finished. Starting gives you an object description from which you can get annotation. You can inject your A/B test manager here. You can change the state, A/B test manager dot put this experiment in treatment. And then in finish, you can clear up your state. So why am I discussing it? Because I'm going to use it to mock network to write reliable UI test. Cool, so one really handy tool I want to show you is UI Automator. We talked about the Fluent API, Espresso Fluent API. There can be a catch here. What if the button is not enabled, but it's not visible? Like something, or if the button is not clickable. And it was, in fact, of disabling the button, we actually make it unclickable. But both look similar, like on UI. So how can we check the state of this button? There's a simple tools. It's available in the SDK/tools folder of Android Automator Viewer, and you can go and check the state of different views. Just to point out, when you are writing UI test, you are not writing it for testing your code, but you are testing the actual user functionality. So you don't have to see the actual code base. What you can do is that you can open up your app in this UI Automator Viewer. You can check the state, you can check the resource IDs also there, and you can write simple UI test based on that. Not only that, you can actually write UI test for other apps also, like not using Espresso, but using Automator Viewer is like one thing. Cool, so the final basic thing I'm going to talk about is custom view matchers. So we discussed about view matchers when we were saying on view with ID, and we find a view matcher with ID, which helps you find a view with resource identifier. What does this custom view matcher does is that, let's say if you have a text view and you want to find a text view with compound drawable R dot drawable dot back button. So what you can do is that you can write a custom view matcher which returns a bounded matcher. This is a bounded matcher on text view. So what it does is that it finds all the text view in that entire view hierarchy, and then it has a simple method, matches safely. This matches safely method iterates over all the, so it gives you all the text view. So this method runs with all the text view in your code. And then you can iterate over all the compound drawables and find if the resource drawable matches, like if this text view have r dot drawable dot back button. If it does, then you can return true, otherwise you can return false. So once it's filtered out, you will get the text view with compound drawable. Cool, so this is a cheat sheet. I'm not going to discuss more about it. We already talked about with ID, there is with text, there is with hint if you are using edit text. There are view actions, click, long click, scroll for list view. Like if you have a login view and if that view is scrollable, and if you have to click button, maybe you have to scroll that view before you can actually click that button. You have data options, those are used for list views. View assertions we talked about matches, and there are so many other things. So yeah, I have added links to all those resources. Cool, so I'm going to talk about recipes now. These are the more interesting things. So first I want to just give one page introduction about build variants. So build variants can be in different flavors. It can be released, the actual thing you upload on Play Store. It can be debug, it can be test, it can be mock, it can be internal. You can switch different configurations. If it's released, maybe we can enable our crash analytics or criticism you provide. If it is debug, then maybe we can just disable SSL, and because we want to see the actual network log, we can enable Stetho. So most of our code we are going to discuss today is not going to live in release. You can put it in debug, test, mock, internal, like something you really don't want the actual user to see. Cool. So So I'm going to first talk about how can we write more reliable UI tests for networks. So this is some app which is making a network call. It's hitting cloud, which is hitting some data source, something. So there are many issues, first of all, hitting network. First is timeout. Your network call may time out, and then it's again memory intensive. Anyone here can who can point me out what can be any other issue when we are actually hitting the actual network call? One really important thing. Cool. Yeah, I guess I can just talk about it. So what if you are using a network request which changed the state on cloud? So let's say if you have a user. So we are testing a functionality where a user have taken two Uber rides. And we are making a, so Uber took his, and now we are testing a code which tests the ride flow. And we made a network call which increased the ride number of rides of that Uber from 2 to 3. If you know, that thing is changing state. So if you are using actual network call and you are getting the request, you are getting the response, the next time you are going to get 3 rides. And so you cannot write reliable UI test if it's changing state. So for fixing timeouts, Espresso gives a very handy tool. It's called idling resource. So by default, Espresso synchronizes on main thread. So it waits for all the activities on main thread to finish before it actually starts testing. That's a big advantage over Appium and other frameworks. So Espresso, how can you synchronize background threads? What you can do is you can use something called counting idling resource, and before you start a long task, you can increment the counting idling resource, and after the long task is finished, you can decrement it. Once your counting idling resource value is equal to 0, that means all your tasks you started are finished, and then you can just register it. So once this count equal to 0, Espresso will start testing. So this is I'm showing an example for schedulers, for executors. If you use Rx Java, you may have used schedulers from dot from executors. This will synchronize even for that. There are custom hooks for existing Rx Java schedulers also. You can just go and have a look. So if I want to synchronize something on Threadpool executor, that I want to make sure that until and unless this Threadpool execute, the task on this Threadpool executor is not finished, I don't want to test. So because I'm making network call or I'm actually loading data from DB on from this thing, and I want to make sure that all those tasks are finished. So before you start tasks, you can, in the execute method, you can do thread count plus plus. And after the task is executed, you can decrease the thread count. And once the thread count is equal to 0, you can just this callback dot on transition to idle. So what it does, it just do the same thing which counting idling source does. Like once you have thread count equal to 0, that means all your background tasks are finished and you can now start doing UI testing. Cool, so this fixed the timeout related issues, but we are still hitting the actual network. So state issue is still there, and also in a big app like production app like Uber, we made many network calls, and imagine and we run our test every time some user push sends some code review or he push something. So even if we are sending like 100 or like let's say 200 code reviews a day, and if we are making an actual, and if we have like let's say around 100 tests and each test is making 2 or 3 network calls, then it's also like 100 into 2 into 200. So we are making like thousands of network calls which are redundant and which are actually hitting our server. It's even more important for startups because server is so costly. Like I have used it in past and I can tell you it's very, very expensive. So what you can do is that when you are writing the test, you can record all the response, and you can store it in a file. You can cache it in a file. You can commit that into your Git repository, and when you are running that test on CI, you can just replay that. So it fixes both these issues. First of all, you are not making those hundreds and thousands of calls, and also it's stateless. Like if you have, if the customer had taken two trips before, like since we are reading back from cache, he had taken two trips every other time also. So I'm gonna use interceptors. So any one of you have used interceptors here, like for something, 2, 3. Anyone of you who are using authenticated requests in your app, like Android app, like you have password, user session, and all those information? Not many. Okay. So yeah, if you are using authenticated requests, the best way is to use interceptors. What interceptors does is that it modifies all your network requests. So if you want to add some header or something to your header, or something you want to add to your all your network calls, the best way is to use the interceptors. Interceptors intercepts all the network calls, so it takes an interceptor dot chain. You can get the request and you can modify the request in some way. Like you can add retries. I'm not sure why are you guys not using retries. The best way to do that is to use an interceptor there itself. So yeah, you can get the request. You have a method chain proceed, which actually helps you make the actual network call, and then you get the response. So first we are going to discuss about record interceptors. So record interceptor, what it does is that when you are making an actual network call, it helps you record the network response. So you made the network call, you got the file name, the request URL, you serialize the net response and save it in your file. So it's gonna store it in your SD card. All you need is a permission to write external storage. You can pull this file and you can commit it to your Git repository. And then when you want to test something, you can just write a very simple rule, add replay record equal to true. So when you did record equal to true in your starting of rule, you can read this thing and you can switch the interceptor to record interceptor. When you want to run it on CI, you can just get rid of record equal to true and it will run in replay interceptors. And replay interceptor does nothing. Instead of making an actual network call, it just reads from the file you saved in your assets. That's it. So now, yeah, now you are not hitting the actual network and you are just reading from the. Cool, so this is the star of this talk, robots. How many of us used some kind of structure in our code, like MVP, MVVM? Like yesterday there was a great talk on that. All right, many, much. So, and how many, and do you guys use some kind of structure for your test case? Like when you write JUnit, some kind of structures, anyone who here use? Okay, no one. So robots is a pattern. It was given in a tech talk by Jake Wharton in Kotlin Nights, and we call it internally layouts. It's a slightly different variant of what Jake Wharton talked about. So this is really cool. It's just gonna like reduce your test class by some multiplier. So let's say this is an app which accepts an email address foo@bar.com, and once you click the send button, it shows you success. But there can be many other cases. Like if you write foo and you click send, the email address is not valid and shows you a failure. Another thing is if you have an empty text and you type send, it's again a failure. Let's say you have many more other cases. You don't want to get a phone, the app, the text should not start with a number, or you don't want to support Yahoo. I mean, it's not that great. So for testing it, what we are doing is that we are writing a view matcher on view with hint. We are writing the foo@bar.com, and then we are clicking the send button with text.perform click, and then we are using, we are checking if the success is visible or not. Similarly, here we are typing text foo, and we are clicking the send button and checking if it failed or not. Similarly, say so. If you notice, like we are repeating code 3 times, and what if someone changed it to recipient X tomorrow? So yeah, I have to go and make this change in all these 3 test cases. So the solution for this is robots. It's kind of MVP for UI test or unit test, or you can use it anywhere. What you can do is that you can extract out these lines on view with hint recipient.perform type text, and you can take text as an input, and you can extract it out in the first one, payment robot recipient, and you can pass foo at bar.com foo here itself, and then you can write similar methods for each of those, and then you have a result robot. Result robot is success, just check if the success text is visible. So you can just now got a fluent API. You can write payment robot dot recipient dot send, and you can check result as success. Cool. The last thing I'm going to talk about is testing, because all of us are writing for apps for India, and we don't have great network in smaller cities, and we also have phones not Nexus one, but yeah. So I just want to show you a list view and a horrible implementation of list view. So what it does is that it inflates the list view every single time, and it finds the view also every single time, no view holder anywhere, and it creates a bitmap also every single time, no glide, no Picasso, it does not reuse bitmap. It's very, very bad. And we can use Espresso to identify like the issues in our app. So what we can do is that we can call list view dot smooth scroll to position and the end position. And before it runs, if your phone is not decent enough, it will definitely crash. So, and then you can similarly use rules. Espresso have several rules which you can use with Monkey Runner. You can go and check it online. So one rule is test tracing, post test dumpses. Lockcat helps you find the lockcat, and netstat give you your net history. So you can use the test tracing tool. And that test tracing tool, what it does is that it generates the sys trace for you. So if your app crashed, you need sys trace to identify what are the issues. So this is sys trace, and I loaded it in Chrome. It shows me the issues with this. So it shows me expensive bitmap uploads. The other F was the measure time was really big. There was another app which was saying that I'm inflating view way too many times, probably I should use view holders. So yeah, you can run it on CI, you will get the crash, you can open those things in your... Cool, so here's the conclusion. Use UI test to identify how your app looks in front of actual user. The network replay record is really important because it lessens the burden on your expensive servers. Use robots. It helps you write much, much less code and much more scalable tests. And finally, use the performance section of Espresso. It's very important because you have phone segmentation, huge phone segmentation, and network is also not that great. Cool. That's it. Any questions?
Hello. Hi.
Yeah. Hi.
Yeah, so I've been using Espresso quite a bit along with Cucumber to do my BDD tests.
Yeah.
So Espresso is mainly for within your app. So something apart from your app pops up, like you use or probably use UI Automator for something like a dialogue that comes up when you're running Nougat or something like that.
Yeah.
But what about push notifications? Do we have something to take care of push notifications?
That's a big catch. So the problem with push notification is you cannot intercept. I think there is some solution, but I'm inside Uber, but I'm definitely not aware of it. Like all those replay and record things, they only work with the polling solutions, HTTP, HTTP2 kind of thing,
right.
But definitely not with push notification.
Okay, so that part of is usually not tested by Uber, is it?
So, I mean, one way I can think of is to write your own. So when you're sending push notification, you can write your own mock notification. But the only problem with that is that you cannot control the time when it's gonna come. Like your pushes, usually you don't control that thing.
Right.
So you can write your own mock notification provider which can fire those notifications.
Okay.
And if you are not testing it, if it's time independent, then that's great. It works for you. And if you are writing push notifications in a way that's time dependent, then definitely something is wrong.
Okay, thank you.
Cool.
So in Espresso, how do you measure actually by number of lines you cover or by the number of cases you cover?
So usually it's not, number of cases can be two things. First of all, it can be number of cases based on your code base. Like if you have written an if else, you want to cover probably both if else. But in Espresso, I'll definitely suggest not to do that. You do that in RoboElectric JUnit. In Espresso, test all your customer facing use case. Like if you have two or three features, write different Espresso tests for those two, three features. Don't write it like for an if else case. So yeah, my recommendation is don't ever look at your code when you're writing Espresso tests. You don't even need to. You can always use UI Automator viewer and you can write your tests accordingly.
We are talking about, we should cover number of lines.
So coverage is, I think, is a concept in Espresso. I really don't know if I can actually map it. Like it's completely different to JUnit. So I don't have a very good answer for this, like how do you measure it? But definitely, I mean, I don't see a point of like coverage.
And one more thing, suppose in any activity, we make a network call on create.
Yeah.
So how do you do by making another activity for it, or you'll kind of a stub activity, or?
Sorry, can you repeat your question?
Suppose you are making a network call on create method.
Yeah.
So how do you measure it? How do you do? How do you?
On delete.
Sorry.
What is the method? Callback, are you saying?
You are making network call.
Okay, so you can usually do the synchronization they provide. If you are using RX Java or like some existing library, like if you are using an executor service, you can synchronize that by using the counting idling resource. If you are using an async task, you are automatically covered by Android. Like loaders in async tasks, Espresso automatically synchronizes on that thing. Just to emphasize one more thing, Espresso actually starts the actual app. So I thought more over it, and I mean I cannot think of like the concept of coverage in Espresso.
Last question.
Hi. So Uber must be doing a lot of testing around location.
Yeah.
How do you do that?
Rules again. So you can write a rule, location rule, at extents rule. Inside this rule, if you have a location client, you can set that, and then I showed you rules right before the custom watcher thing. So what you can do is that, and inside with annotations, you can also pass values. So with annotation X, you can actually pass value. Like I need 23 Fahrenheit. I need 23 degree 23 latitude, maybe 66 longitude, and I want that only these type of Ubers will be available. So what you can do is that you can pass all these values. So I mean I don't work on anything specific to that, but and I don't know if it's the actual way, if it's the exact way it's implemented in Uber, but I mean I don't see a reason why it will not be a rule. Like the best part is in your finished, all your locations are cleared and you don't have to tear it down every time. So your UI test will be like really reliable.
Okay, so you are saying that for all instrumentations possible, such as GPS, Bluetooth, NFC, Wi-Fi, we can have rules for all of them, right?
Yeah, you can definitely have rules for all
rules for all of them.
Yeah, you can just change. You must be having something like observable or some iterable which you are reading. Like you have a location client, you connect to that, and then in unconnected. So you can actually change that location client inside this starting, and you can make it emit event here itself.
Can you show any example of such?
We can discuss it definitely. Like I can show you an example of that, not in Uber, but outside I have seen someone using it that way.
Okay, I'd like to see that. Thank you.
Sure.
Thanks everyone. We'll be closing questions now because we're running a little late. We're off for break right now, but we'll resume at 11:50 exactly. So please be back. Thanks, Harshit.